14.2, the multiplier model. The purpose of this model is to show how an initial change in the spending side of the economy, in the demand side of the economy, can get amplified. Let's say how a reduction in spending in the economy can push the economy into a vicious circle of lower spending, lower production, lower spending, lower production. But what's the reason behind this vicious circle? To understand that, let's just go back to the circular flow model. Here's that model. This model shows us that someone's spending is another person's income. Let's say for whatever reasons, households panic and they start to reduce their spending, then the firms will cut down their production and fire their workers. If firms fire their workers, this means the households will have less money to spend. And if they spend less, the firms have to cut down their production. So you see the logic behind this vicious circle. Now let's go back to the multiplier model and show this process through a graph. So we go back and start to scroll down. And here's our model. The x-axis has the total output in the economy, and the y-axis is total spending, total aggregate demand. And this line, the 45-degree line, represents the case where the spending is equal to total output. In other words, there's no shortage or excess of demand in the economy. Now we want to model the spending side and show how changes in the spending side can impact the output. The first component of total spending is consumption, and the consumption itself has two components. The first component of it is autonomous consumption. This is the amount that we spend that is not dependent of our current income. If our current income goes to zero, we're gonna spend this amount anyway. Maybe our household has a lot of savings. Maybe our household has access to credit. So we're gonna spend this amount anyway. We call that autonomous consumption. The second component of consumption is the variable consumption, and that depends on our current income. And if our current income goes up, we're going to spend a fraction of that. And we call that marginal propensity to consume. Now, the higher our marginal propensity to consume, it means this line will be steeper. The lower the marginal propensity to consume, this line would be flatter. This means that our consumption is less reliant on our current income. We are doing more consumption smoothing. So far, we modeled total consumption in our economy, and that's represented by this line. Now we need to add another component to our spending, and that's investment. And here we are thinking of this investment as autonomous, as independent of the total output and income in our economy. So we represent investment by this distance. Now, this line represents the total aggregate demand, the total spending in our economy. The next step, we want to show you how an initial change in aggregate demand can push the economy into a vicious circle. So let's scroll down. Here's the exact multiplier model that we discussed above, and A represents the equilibrium. Why? Because the aggregate demand is equal to aggregate output at point A. And in order to better understand why this is an equilibrium, let's think of a situation when the economy is not in an equilibrium. Let's think of point B. There, we have excess demand in our economy. People are rushing to shops to buy goods. Firms are running out of stocks. Queues are forming outside of shops. And in this situation, firms can respond in two ways. They can either increase their prices or, as depicted in this graph, increase their output and hire more workers. Also, we can think about the opposite case. For instance, the economy experiences a shortage of demand, and in response, the firms can either reduce their prices or reduce the outputs to get back to point A. So I gave you an idea why point A is an equilibrium. Now I want to explain to you how an initial drop in aggregate demand can push the economy into a vicious circle of lower spending and lower output. So let's start. Now let's assume for whatever reason our firms panic and they decide to cut down on their investment. So the demand for investment drops by 1.5 billion. This represents a shortage of demand in our economy. And in response, the firms that are producing investment machineries, investment goods, cut down on their output by 1.5 billion. Therefore, the income also goes down by 1.5 billion. Now, it's important to mention that here we are assuming that firms are not decreasing their prices in response to the drop in demand. In response, they are decreasing their production, their output. So to summarize, we had a fall in the investment demand by 1.5 billion, and this fall translated to a fall of output by 1.5 billion. This is the first round effect. But the story does not stop here. Now, the second round, as income drops, consumption also drops. Why? Because as you remember, part of your consumption depends on your current income. And if your current income falls by 1.5 billion, the consumption should drop, but by a fraction of 1.5 billion. So the drop in consumption would be to a lesser degree. Here, our economy again faces a shortage of demand for consumer goods. In response, the firms cut down on their output, fire workers, income falls. As income falls, the consumption should also fall. So you have a vicious circle until you reach to a new equilibrium, which is represented by point Z here. Here, your economy finally stabilizes at a situation where you have a much lower level of aggregate spending and output. So you see, the multiplier model tells us an initial drop in 1.5 billion of investment demand have kickstarted rounds of negative effects, rounds of reduction in spending and output until our economy reaches to a new equilibrium. This model shows us the initial drop in 1.5 billion have translated to a much bigger drop in output, a drop of 3.75 billion. And here we get the size of multiplier. The multiplier is the drop in output, 3.75 billion, divided by the fall in spending, 1.5 billion. We get 2.5. In the end, let me go through the assumptions that this model is making. The first assumption is that firms respond to any changes in the aggregate demand by adjusting their output instead of adjusting their prices. So we are assuming that the prices are fixed. The second assumption is that some of the households are credit constrained. They cannot fall back on their past wealth, or they can't access credit from the banks. Therefore, they're not able to smooth out their consumption. Of course, there are some households that are able to smooth out their consumption. So the model is not saying that there is complete smoothing of consumption or complete lack of access to credit. The model is saying that on the aggregate level, the economy is made of different households. Some of them are able to smooth out their consumption. We put them in the autonomous consumption. Some of them are not able to smooth out their consumption. They're credit constrained. And finally, this model assumes that there is no government and the economy is closed. The aggregate demand is made of only two components, consumption and investment. Now, in the end, let me talk about the solution. So what happens if an economy experiences an initial drop in aggregate demand? What's the solution? What's the appropriate policy for the government to follow to make sure that the economy does not fall into a vicious circle of lower spending, lower output? Now, the government can come up with two series of policies. The first one is fiscal policy. It could boost the spending in the economy. The government can become the spender of last resort, or it could lower taxes for the households and firms. The other policy is monetary policy. It can lower the nominal interest rates and boost the aggregate demand. Both of these policies are aimed at changing the aggregate demand, and you're going to read more of them in the subsequent sections. Thank you.